morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for inviting me to Kingston, especially to Keith. Last time I was in Canada, I was there for 2 more days than planned because I was affected by the Icelandic volcano incidents while being at a conference in Montreal. I enjoyed it for 2 more days. So I'm happy to be back in Canada and to be able to talk a bit about a slightly more political economy type of story about the German experience, German way maybe to find also some path to adjust the institutions that are out there in the welfare state, in the labor market, to the challenges of this future of work, digitization phenomenon that is hotly debated, not only in Germany, but also basically in all developed, but also even the developing countries these days. So the motivation behind that, and I think Germany was maybe one of the early adopters of that whole terminology of this 4.0 metaphor, was initially more like an engineering, technologically oriented discourse among experts that developed the idea of this Internet of Things affecting in particular manufacturing. And when talking about Germany, you need to know, and I assume you all know that, that manufacturing is very important in determining the overall functioning of the German employment system, in particular the core of the labor market that relies heavily on export-oriented quality manufacturing and the skilled labor force. So Industry 4.0 was, I think, coined in Germany maybe in the early years of this decade. And from there, the debate started to go broad about the 4.0 metaphor, but also to go slightly deeper and into slightly different areas within Germany. On the one hand, productivity and competitiveness concerns, i.e. early development and early adoption of innovative technological solutions, in particular in the productive system. But society, policymakers, stakeholders also got increasingly maybe worried, but at least concerned about some of these implications that this may have on the labor market and on human resource policies within companies. There's the issue of the future fate, let's say, of the medium-skilled positions. I will show you some graphs that you already know from the OECD in a second. The polarization issue, the casualization issue on the labor market, this was one of the major motivations why there was a political exercise to try to find out how to deal with that. And the other thing, it was especially highlighted from a trade union perspective, that is still very important also in Germany, is to complement sort of a technologically oriented discourse by a human-centric scenario that also involves, let's say, the social implications and the implications for the individuals, for the labor force, but also for co-determination and collective bargaining as a way to adjust institutions so that good jobs can also be maintained or created newly in the foreseeable future. What about Germany? You have seen that graph already from Stein. It's actually based on the study that also Susan mentioned by Arndt and Gregory, who is a colleague of mine at ICA now. Fear here is that Germany may not be ideally located as regards the risk of automated job losses. You can see here that both indicators reach relatively high figures in the German case, meaning that there may be quite a few still routine-oriented jobs that are susceptible to automation. And that could, in principle, also mean a number of manufacturing jobs, of medium-skilled jobs, not just, let's say, elementary occupations. So there's something to be worried, and of course, also in Germany, the whole debate started with the Frey and Osborne study, basically, in 2013, where the terminology of automation really got prominent and led to a couple of replication studies. And the other thing also from the OECD is this polarization. So Germany does not like a polarization in the labor market. So everything that is somehow threatening a somewhat egalitarian employment model is worrying, and it receives immediate public attention, and losing in particular jobs in the medium skill segment that are nicely integrated into the welfare state, into collective bargaining, in co-determination in medium and bigger companies is particularly worrying. So there is something to be concerned about, and this is why a couple of challenges were identified. I think they are not particularly different from, in general, not particularly different from the outlook regarding other countries. Forecast that I just skipped here, this is an official forecast that was done for the German Ministry of Labor, basically assumes more or less stable, a stable scenario in terms of the total number of jobs, but huge differences until 2030 in terms of employment developments in different sectors. I do not have to highlight them separately, but employment reshuffling across sectors and across occupations is a major issue. So rather than, let's say, an imminent loss of overall employment, that has nicely increased over the last 10 years, by the way. So the second point that also motivated policy debates about the issue of work 4.0 is, of course, the fact that the German system of more like incremental innovation in the manufacturing sector is particularly vulnerable or seen as potentially vulnerable to a more disruptive type of technological change that is at least implicitly present in the artificial intelligence / digitization phenomenon. Third point, also important here to note, is that new types of occupations, new types of businesses are not particularly well integrated into established forms of collective bargaining and co-determination at the firm level, because they basically operate outside of these more traditional and slowly evolving, if not declining, institutions. Fourth point, as a motivation behind that, Germany is also one of the most rapidly aging and even one of the oldest labor forces in the developed world. So even that comes as an additional point that we need to tackle older workers, longer working lives in a situation of quick, potentially accelerating technological change. And last point, the potential erosion of social insurance funding if there is a movement away from the dependent employee type of employment relationship to a more self-employment platform work model. Empirically, this is not relevant in Germany, so Germany would also still fit into the lower bound figures that Stein has shown, certainly below 1% regarding the platform employees, but there is at least some concern that this may increase in some sectors, in some activities over the next years. So against this background, I would like to highlight that there was, I think, one of the first maybe systematic discourses about Work 4.0 and the implications of digitization of work in the German labor market, initiated by the German government some 3 years ago, trying to consult and to find out what's going on and what should be done together with social partners and independent experts. And I think this is a very nice endeavor, showing how policymakers wanted to come to terms with this largely uncertain and unknown phenomenon, and also to find a way to adapt institutions into the foreseeable future, participating were social partners, but also HR specialists. And what is important here, I take this down there, with regard to formats. There were experts dialogue also involving, most notably, not just the traditional trade unions and employer associations, but also associations of freelancers, for example, of self-employed workers in the creative occupations, in the consulting business, and also independent researchers. So just to open up the traditional corporatist tripartite type of dialogue to also include new actors and potentially more becoming actors or sectors that are becoming increasingly important. So this dialogue lasted for almost 2 years in 2015 and 2016. And there was a final concluding paper that was released in early 2017, about 1.5 years ago, that is freely available also in English on the website of the German Ministry of Labor and Social Affairs, trying to put down the number of points that are to be discussed. Not necessarily transformed directly into policy solutions that can easily be adopted, but at least issues that need further attention and have jointly been identified by those involved in the discourse. So I think given the fact that all these topics will be on the agenda for the conference here for 2 days, I will not go that much into detail, but there were basically 4 pillars that received a huge attention from stakeholders, but also from government. The lifelong learning thing, I think it's obvious, it has been mentioned, it's important, and from a German perspective and from a trade union perspective, it is very important to upgrade skills and competences, in particular of those people with medium and low skills, even when they are not yet at the risk of losing their job or have not yet lost their job, i.e. before they become target groups of traditional active labor market policies. And the basic idea here is that some skill upgrading of the medium segment of the labor force would potentially help stabilize this type of, segment of the labor market that is so important for the stability of the economic model and also the funding of the welfare state. Second issue, and maybe this is less of a focus here at the seminar, flexibility at work and working time policies. This has been highly highlighted, in particular also from the trade union side, basically balance issues of self-determination on the one hand with employment or employer requirements regarding working time flexibility, and also to avoid, let's say, over exploitation and extremely long working time at the firm level, especially being available while not being at your place of work. So to establish at least some rules, some negotiations on this issue. Health and safety, again, also an issue here, has something to do in particular with the psychological aspects of digitization and work intensification. This has received some attention and maybe also some ideas for future policies. I'm not saying just regulation or suppressing anything, but it could also mean creating some sort of incentives for employers to pursue more sustainable HR policies in that field. And last but not least, the issue of social protection. In a Bismarckian welfare state where social insurance is mostly focused on dependent employees, a potential rise in self-employment would create a considerable challenge, I would say. And therefore, especially those who are interested in avoiding old age poverty and also to open up unemployment benefits to the self-employed have put up this point on the agenda. To be honest, regarding empirical data also, we have not seen an increase in self-employment over the last 10 years in Germany when measuring it with standard surveys. But even if we do focus surveys on certain side activities or platform-based activities, this is not a major issue. And I think maybe the time series data would not look much different from what Susan has presented regarding the US, this 0.5 to 1% gig economy type of activities. It may be leveling off now, yeah, because there are also some organizational barriers, I think, to outsourcing of tasks and to splitting up work into very tiny marginal jobs. Anyway, these were the issues on the agenda, and as you may imagine, positions of main actors, well, they are characterized by, on the one hand, some sort of a convergence regarding some productivity interests in safeguarding employment on the one hand, but there are certainly also some differences between employers that were consulted, but also the trade unions, especially regarding the need for stricter regulation. Yeah? So the employer side is basically happy with a very flexible environment, and the trade unions more or less emphasize the risks that they see emerging at the horizon. And government, I would say, is mostly interested in maintaining stable welfare state funding on the one hand, but also in keeping unemployment low, and therefore a strong emphasis also in skill training and in potentially modernizing social insurance over the next years. The white paper from early 2017, I will be concluding soon, then came up with a couple of more concrete ideas to be elaborated on, and actually there will be further consultation and preparation maybe for legislation now with a new government that came into power in early 2018. I would like to highlight five points, starting with the last one. Germany is also considering putting more emphasis and more investment into a regular reporting on the changing world of work. So there's one thing that's quite similar to what Canada is doing and what the US are doing, regular reporting. There may be systematic assessment of studies that pop up so that we have sort of a mutually shared understanding of what's going on in the labor market and, well, have some sort of a realistic assessment of what's really going on. So, but let me go back to the first point. There's also a long-standing idea of making the unemployment insurance more, let's say, proactive or preventative in a way. Maybe a bit moving also in the direction that Canada has gone to open up this also to training of those who are not unemployed or not yet unemployed. And also increase, let's say, the autonomy of the insured person as regards investing certain funds into training. That could well mean also that Germany looks closer at the French example of the Compersonnel d'Activité, where there is this transferable individual budget that can be used for training. So this is something that may be a serious policy issue for the next 2 or 3 years. So, second point, making working time more employee-oriented by allowing or creating a statutory right to reduce working time, but also to return to full-time work. This is something that has already been implemented now and for certain groups, for certain firms. Third point, expanding social insurance to the self-employed, especially the old age pension system, because there's a huge concern regarding poor formerly self-employed being dependent on tax-funded, means-tested income support in the old age if they do not properly contribute to old age pension savings. And what Stein mentioned, this artist social insurance system is a very specific type that is out there in Germany since the early 1980s, but the access to this is very restricted to very few categories of artists, writers, actors, painters, and people like that. It is not fully open to many types of new self-employed. So there may be an issue to make this more general and then also to consider how to organize funding. Yeah? If it's pure funding from the self-employed or if there will be some sort of co-funding from the clients or from the customer side, from maybe from the platforms or through the tax budget. So this is still open and needs further discussion. It is very difficult to move from these mutually understood challenges to concrete institutional adaptations, and the same and very difficult is also the stabilization of social partnership and collective bargaining if this is not running at the grassroots level. So I think this is also a huge concern. I would like to conclude with a couple of insights from this, let's say, interim status that we're currently in. I would say, and I think this also resonates with a couple of points that have been mentioned here today, is that many of the issues that were identified as core institutional challenges regarding Work 4.0 go back to old debates about modernizing the labor market and the welfare state. That have not yet, challenges that have not yet been met, but they seem to be maybe becoming more pressing in the near future. The second point that I find important is that actors seem to be very strongly interested in linking technological innovation with social innovation and are quite open at least to collect data, to assess data, and then to see what's really going on and if some of the assumed challenges really exist or how also to find some sort of innovative policy solutions. So there may also be a certain potential to identify win-win constellations quite easily in the future of work sphere, as long as there is a joint interest in maintaining productive employment. And this allows then also to maybe use a more flexible tripartite approach that is not typical collective bargaining or social pacting, so to speak, in a European tradition, but also involves a couple of new actors and maybe also new organizational forms, especially on the trade union or the side of the organization of the self-employed workers. There is a remarkable gap between public attention discourse and in concrete policies. I think this one has also to admit. So it becomes even more difficult once you start really tackling these hard issues of welfare state adjustment or of some sort of a regulatory policy that may look quite easy to solve at a general level, but when it becomes to concrete policy making, it becomes very difficult. The same is actually true also for more general or more universal access to lifelong learning that has also not been really solved yet. Last point before I conclude. I think it's also important, it's not so easy in terms of the political economy how to solve that, to avoid the dominance of old interests in the discussion about the future of work, yeah, because the best established actors are those of the incumbent sectors and in the incumbent occupations. They may not be the ideal partners when you talk about the future of work and maybe some newly emerging types of work or types of activities. So this must also be properly encouraged in a way through public discourse so that also these new types of activities are properly represented and have a say on the issues that are at stake for the future of work. Thank you very much for your attention.